back in.
Every 23rd spring, for 23 days, the creeper gets to eat. Was written so that there would never be a sequel to Jeepers Creepers, ironically enough. That was my very smart writer's way of saying, they're not going to turn this into a tentpole where you just get so tired of these movies that you don't see too many of them. I say, my creeper only shows up for 23 days at a time, which means the next movie, they'd have to shoot it in the future or shoot it in the past, and they'd never do that. It was Francis or somebody who found it to be deceptively simple. You just make it part of the same 23 days. Since we don't know when the first one took place, was it on day one or something, that there could be an endless stream of these things? I wasn't that clever to think that out.
Johnny! Open the fucking doors, man! Open the goddamn doors!
Francis Ford Coppola convinced me to do the sequel. We both saw it as an opportunity to come back and do the first one again the way I really wanted to, which was with a lot of big suspense, action, and horror kind of put together, because those three don't come together very often. My original Jeepers script had Trish, surviving sister, going after the creeper with Giselle, the psychic, and a lot of the other characters from the first film. And the kids trapped in a bus was like a subplot that helped flesh out that story of them hunting the creeper. However, the more the story progressed, the most interesting part of the story became these kids trapped on this bus. And that's when I realized that I was missing the juiciest part of my own story.
I talked to Victor several times, and he says he tries to come from like old school. So it's like, you know, The Thing and, you know, the old school monster movies. So he doesn't want to do so much blood and guts. He wants to do more like fright and suspense.
I don't know, Victor has like a really cool, twisted mind in the ways that he tells stories, and he's just a cool artist.
After bragging on the first DVD for Jeepers about how my films are always about one person, I find it very ironic that now I have like 12 speaking kids and about 10 others trapped on this bus. I really wanted to push my own envelope and see, okay, your movies are always about one person. What if you have to have this sort of community of people?
The fuck? Is it looking at me?
I think I would go back, and now when I write for large groups of people, I would try and get their character down in the opening scene with just a couple of lines, because there is an art form, I think, to fleshing characters out without having to give each one of them their individual scene, especially in a film like this.
Listen to me, piece of shit!
He looked at you too, bro. I saw him and you did too. He looked right at you and smiled.
We again went out and did a huge casting call. Some of the principals were completely new. They'd never been in a movie before. Travis Schiffner, who plays Izzy, had never done a picture before, and turned out to be really impressive.
The actors are great. I mean, this really is a strong cast, so I think that it really broadens it, because you got character actors, so. I mean, even though it's a young cast.
Actually, the actor who plays Izzy, Travis, we actually worked at Hamburger Hamlet together, so it was kind of cool to see him on the set.
Eric Neninger, who plays Scotty, he'd never done a feature before. He'd done a couple of seasons on Malcolm in the Middle.
Everybody that I know read for this movie, every young actor, he's cool because he gives young actors a chance that haven't worked on anything. This is my first feature film that I've done at all, so I was great. You know, it was a perfect thing to start with.
Gary Kai Mutambirwa, who plays Double D, you know, he'd been in a couple of features, but never one that focused on him so much.
Victor told me what he wanted to see in Double D, and I totally agreed with that. So it's basically talking with the director and seeing how he reacts to these situations. It tells you a lot about how the character is.
There's no feeling that's more gratifying than giving some talented kid a shot at something and having them run with it.
I've always wanted to be in a horror movie. I thought, you know, I would get past that point in my career where I couldn't play teenagers anymore, and then I wouldn't have done a horror movie, so I'm really happy to have this job.
Our cast is 10 or 15, so it's a big cast, and it's laid back, it's fun atmosphere, there's so many people to hang out with and talk to. It's a great experience, it's really fun.
Since we've been on set, as a matter of fact, it's very hard to get the bus quiet. They talk so much because we're all goofing around and laughing and running around the trailers together, and it's been a lot of fun.
One of the reasons why I think I like taking chances on new people is that if everyone felt that way, including Francis Coppola, I wouldn't be making movies. He took a chance on somebody new, and it was me. You know, he took a chance on some kid who said, hey, I can do this. And so I try and return the favor and send that into the universe where, you know, I'm paying it forward, perhaps, you know, to give these kids their chance because I got my chance. And like I say, sometimes it just pays off beautifully. Yeah! Very impressed by a good action film or a film that incorporates visual effects in a way that really helps tell the story. And one of my, you know, still trying to prove myself here in the early part of my career is I wanted to know if I could do a big action film and really pull off these action sequences.
This movie basically picks up where the first one left off. Last scene of the last movie, the creeper goes flying out a window, and that's right where we pick it up here. The creeper's airborne in nearly every scene. So there's lots of flying rigs, lots of ratchets, lots of wire work. Basically, what we had to pull together tonight was the character named Taggart shoots the creeper with a harpoon gun and a big spear, shoots him in the left shoulder, sending him flying through the air. So what we've done today is a ratchet hooked to Darren Prescott, who is our creeper double. And we've given him a little twist, literally. We've actually given him two or three wraps, which simulates him being shot off center, sending him twisting and flying through the air.
Yeah, basically Monty Simmons, a stunt coordinator, came up with the idea in pre-production when they were gonna shoot him with the harpoon, and he knew we could do these sort of ratchets. And I think he figured it would fit in really well with the storyboards and the action they had laid out. We've done these sort of before like this, obviously not off a school bus, dressed like a creeper at night, but similar applications on other shows, so we kind of knew this was just the right tool for the job.
3, 2, 1, go!
You know, it's funny because when we signed the contract, we signed to do our own stunts, so I'm thinking, wow, I'm gonna have to be ratcheted like 50 feet in the air, you know? I was really thinking I had to do like all this crazy stuff, but not really. I mean, we lay on the ground sometimes and this and that, but the professional stuff, the ratchets and people getting jerked off their feet, we would just die. We'd get killed doing this stuff.
We've simulated the creeper dropping out of the sky and snatching these kids up and ratcheting them back up into the sky, which is a similar situation to what we've just done here.
3, 2, 1, go!
There are, I think, 5 digital shots in Jeepers 1, and I think there's about 140 in Jeepers 2. And we were lucky to have our special effects supervisor on set with us every day.
When we're out here representing the visual effects side of the film, usually we're focusing on what's not in camera and not seen a lot of the times. Most important things for us are making sure we get the right lighting, and we take a lot of lighting samples while we're out here. We take a lot of camera information, always keeping in mind what's in the frame, what's not in the frame, what we have to add, and sometimes have an opportunity to help out with the action of how the motion of things are going on, how the shot's set up, a lot of the second camera stuff. We help set up the shots to make sure that we get what we need in it. We're shooting a lot of it on green screen that will then apply CG wings for it, but it really, when the moves start getting complicated or when we want to fly them a great distance or something like that, and Victor wants to get really creative on the look of the film and what he's doing with the creeper, then we kind of take that into the digital realm.
All you kids, get down!
I've been trying to put together what I call my film family since the first time I made a film. You know, I'm looking for people that I have a rapport with, who I enjoy working with, and who seem to understand, like, you know, what I'm trying to communicate. My DP, Don Fauntleroy, this is our third film together.
You don't get this opportunity to light up 3/4 of a mile of road at night and a half a mile across. I mean, this is twice in my career since being a cinematographer, both times with Victor, both times on Jeepers. So it's worked out really well. It's fun. The lights that we were talking about are the Dinos that are up on the Condors over here. There's a night sun over there. In fact, there's a night sun sitting right here on the ground that we're about to put in the air. It's got three 24 light units on it.
I use the same makeup and effects house because I find Brian Penicus and Makeup and Monsters match their talent with enthusiasm. And I need people that are excited about what we're doing too, because I need to feed off their enthusiasm in the same way they need to feed off mine.
To completely put them in the entire suit that we're doing tonight, it takes about 4 hours. So they have to start us really early so they can take advantage of the limited night darkness that they have during the summer.
What makes a good scary movie, I think, is when the situations and the characters are real. If it's somebody that we're laughing at or somebody we can't really identify with, we can sit in the audience and have our popcorn and, you know, cheer the bad guy on, et cetera, et cetera. But when the characters are written well and when they're real, I think it makes it really scary because we identify with them.
One of the things I hope the film does is nestle you in this community of kids that feels very real, and then when darkness descends upon them, you find their inner machinations very interesting. In fact, that's kind of really what drives the movie. I wouldn't have that if I didn't find these really exceptional kids, and I'm really thrilled with all of them, I have to say.
I really love the way Victor works with his actors. He works individually, I've noticed. I thought at first, you know, wow, he really works with me very well, and I can't believe it just so happens. It's a coincidence that he works the same as me. But Victor, I noticed with the other actors, he works with actors based on, he can see how to get the best work out of them. I think that's a really smart, very intelligent director to take, you know, 12-something actors and be able to work with them all on their own terms.
From the very beginning, I was completely relaxed. He just makes us all feel really comfortable and makes us kind of feel like a family.
He says he believes in letting actors run with what they have. Every once in a while, he'll give you just a little bit and he'll say, change this, bring it up, give me just a little more. Nailed this one. He doesn't say much, but when he does say it, he knows just how to say it. And he's just nice about it.
You waiting for something?
About 3 more days. Give or take a day or two.
The whole idea of Jeepers 2 is about this community of people that is threatened by this dark force. And there are some people in the community who get so scared and so concerned about their own interest that they decide that they're going to divide and conquer with fear so they can protect themselves and their own interest. However, that ends up very bad for them. And the outcasts of the movie decide to stick together and they survive. That's my way of trying to take my monster movie, because it is a monster movie, and I have no delusions that it's anything more than that. Trying to tell another story within the trappings of my little dark fables that I tell. So I think there's a beautiful heart inside Jeepers 2, and hopefully it's all wrapped up in a great little roller coaster ride that reminds us that there's nasty stuff out there, but we really need to come together as one planet and one people if we're gonna get through the real nightmares of the world. Mm-hmm.